Terima kasih kepada Bapak, Ibu, serta rekan-rekan peneliti atau mungkin dosen karena telah bersedia meluangkan waktu untuk mengikuti acara webinar Science Worker pagi ini. Bagaimana kabarnya pagi hari ini? Semoga sehat-sehat selalu. Baik, sebelum kita memulai kegiatan webinar yang insya Allah akan bermanfaat ini, ada baiknya kita berdoa terlebih dahulu. Semoga acara yang kita lakukan ini dapat diberkahi oleh Tuhan Yang Maha Esa. Berdoa menurut agama dan kepercayaan masing-masing dimulai. Ya, berdoa selesai. Baik, Bapak atau Ibu dan rekan-rekan semua, perkenalkan saya Cintara Rahmagiyarti, panggil saya Cinte, yang akan membersamai rekan-rekan sebagai MC dan moderator pada acara webinar pagi ini dengan tema The Fluorescence Way, Why Start Fluorescence Western Blotting Now. Pada webinar ini, kita akan mendapatkan informasi terkait penggunaan multiple fluorescence dalam Western Blotting. Jadi meliputi alasan digunakannya multiple fluorescence, prinsip dasar, alur kerja, serta tips dan trik dalam pengaplikasiannya dalam penelitian kita. Baik, sebelum kita mulai acara webinar ini, saya akan memperkenalkan pembicara kita pagi ini. Pada webinar ini akan ada dua pembicara. Yang pertama adalah Mas Kurdianto, selaku Product Manager dari PT Science Worker. Dan yang kedua adalah Miss Angeli Koh. Good morning, Miss Angeli. I hope you are in good health, Miss.
Ya, selamat pagi.
Selamat pagi. Baik, izinkan saya untuk menjelaskan aturan webinar pagi ini dalam bahasa Inggris agar pembicara kita juga dapat mengetahui aturan tersebut. Oke, the Science Worker webinar will begin with a presentation by Mas Kurdianto as the first speaker and then Angeli Koh as the second speaker. After the presentation by two speakers, there will be a question and answer session. When the speaker bring the presentation, if you have a question, you can type the question on the question and answer or Q&A icon below on the chat. Please give your name and who you want to be asked. Also, you can ask a question in Indonesian language. We will translate your question briefly, and after the presentation session is over, a question will be asked to the speaker. I will share the absent link to get free certificate at the end of the webinar. All right, now I will introduce the first speaker, Mas Kurdianto. He is a product manager for proteomic division at PT Science Worker. He will briefly introduce PT Science Worker company profile, especially the proteomic division to us. Mas Kurdianto would like to presentation in Indonesian language because most of the audience is Indonesian, so the audience can more easily understand the content of the presentation. Okay, without wasting time, I would like to Mas Kurdianto to give the presentation for 15 minutes, ya Mas. So this time
okay.
So this time is for you, Mas Kurdianto.
Thank you, Mbak Cindera. I will share my screen. Sorry. Where's my screen? So all windows. Okay. Mbak, sudah terlihat slide-nya, Mbak?
Sudah, Mas. Sudah jelas terlihat.
Oke. Ya, selamat pagi, Bapak-Ibu sekalian. Selamat sejahtera untuk kita semua. Ya, pada hari ini saya ingin sedikit memperkenalkan apa itu ScienceWork, kemudian apa saja yang bisa kita support untuk keperluan riset Western Blot ataupun yang lain dari Bapak-Ibu sekalian. Jadi, ScienceWork itu adalah perusahaan distributor laboratorium, ya, di mana kita merupakan salah satu leading distributor laboratorium di Indonesia yang bisa mensupport lengkap, ya, berbagai lini dari mulai proteomik, ya, kemudian genomik, lalu selomik, bioimaging, analytical serta applied science, seperti itu. Nah, tim kita merupakan hampir semua ya, semuanya adalah profesional yang memiliki basic science ya. Kemudian kita juga memiliki beberapa tim, ada sales team, kemudian application team, kemudian ada product manager dan engineer ya, di mana semuanya ini di hire ya untuk bisa memberikan produk yang terbaik ya dan pelayanan terbaik untuk Bapak Ibu sekalian. Nah, moto kita adalah making science work for you. Nah, PT ScienceWorks sendiri ya, merupakan perusahaan yang cukup besar ya, di mana untuk di luar negeri sendiri kita ada cabang di Malaysia, Singapura, kemudian ada di Myanmar ya. Di representative office yaitu di Jakarta untuk kantor pusatnya. Kemudian kita juga punya kantor di Yogyakarta ya, Yogyakarta branch ya untuk Jawa Tengah. Untuk area timur kita punya kantor di Surabaya ya, di Jalan Duku Kupang itu. Nah, ini yang tadi sudah disampaikan bahwa kita memiliki complete solution ya, dari mulai genomic, kemudian proteomic, cell biology, analytical sampai dengan applied science. Namun di sini saya ingin meng-highlight produk apa saja ya yang yang kita support untuk khususnya proteomik gitu ya. Nah, di proteomik itu kita mensupport beberapa produk ya. Yang pertama adalah produk untuk question blotting workflow. Jadi dari mulai proses preparasi sampel sampai dengan analisis ya. Kemudian kita juga support untuk gel imaging system, dari mulai yang gel documentation system sampai dengan chemiluminescence ya. Kemudian kita juga support untuk ELISA kit, antigen dan antibodinya. Itu bisa keperluan misalnya antibody ataupun antigen untuk keperluan western blotting dan lain-lain. Kemudian kita juga support untuk alat dan sistem purifikasi protein, yaitu NGC ataupun next generation chromatography. Kemudian yang terakhir adalah kita juga support untuk yang produk akhir ya. Jadi biasanya setelah kita purifikasi protein, kemudian mix dengan antibody antigen, biasanya ingin membuat semacam produk lateral flow assay. Nah, ini kita juga support untuk lateral flow assay workflow ya, dari mulai dispensing sampai dengan cassette assembly dan QC seperti itu. Nah, hari ini saya ingin fokus mengenai Western blotting workflow ya. Nah, ini adalah workflow di Western Blot ya, di mana proses Western Blot itu dimulai dengan proses preparasi sampel ya. Kemudian untuk memastikan sampel itu memiliki konsentrasi yang baik, kualitas yang baik, adalah kita juga biasanya melakukan sampel quantification ataupun sampel quantitation, lalu kemudian dilanjutkan dengan elektroporasis dan blotting, dan terakhir adalah imaging dan analisis ya. Ini adalah tahapan Western Blot. Nah, untuk sample preparation, kita support dari mulai total protein extraction. Jadi, jika Bapak-Ibu sekalian memiliki beberapa jenis protein, ingin mengekstrak total protein, ya kita bisa support kit-nya, namanya Ready Prep Protein Extraction Kit. Ini adalah total protein, ya, di mana kit ini juga bisa digunakan untuk berbagai jenis sampel, dari mulai jaringan hewan, tumbuhan, sel, kultur sel, ya, dan lain-lain. Ya. Kemudian kita juga punya produk yang dikhususkan misalnya untuk mammalian cell, yeast cell, kemudian bakteria ya. Selain itu juga kita support untuk deterjen. Biasanya proses purifikasi ekstraksi protein ya secara konvensional itu menggunakan berbagai jenis deterjen, dari mulai SDS, kemudian Triton X, lalu dengan misalnya ada CHEPS dan lain-lain. Itu juga kita support untuk total protein extraction. Lalu biasanya setelah kita ekstraksi, ini kita ingin mendapatkan protein yang lebih murni misalnya. Karena misalnya di beberapa sampel itu memiliki banyak kandungan garam, ataupun misalnya lipid, kemudian deterjen, dan lain-lain. Kita juga support produk untuk bisa membersihkan itu ya. Kita memiliki produk untuk membersihkan protein dari salt removal, misalnya proteinnya memiliki banyak garam. Kita punya Ready Prep 2D Clean Up Kit ya. Kemudian ini adalah clean up kit juga, jadi ready clean up ini bisa membersihkan salt ataupun garam-garam, kemudian deterjen dalam satu sampel. Jadi ketika nanti pengujian itu sampelnya akan jauh lebih murni seperti itu. Nah, selanjutnya adalah Sure Beads, magnetic beads. Jadi ini adalah dikhususkan untuk proses isolasi protein, di mana biasanya ada beberapa protein khusus ya, yang isolasinya menggunakan metode immunoprecipitation. Nah, jadi alat ini bisa digunakan untuk proses immunoprecipitation, di mana kita bisa mengisolasi antibody, baik itu IgG, IgM, ya, dan beberapa jenis yang lainnya, menggunakan protein A dan protein G. Jadi untuk magnet ini kita punya alat magnetiknya, ini adalah magnetic rack-nya, kemudian ini adalah beads yang telah dikonjugasikan dengan protein E. Jadi proses isolasinya sangat mudah dan cepat ya, kita cukup menambahkan magnetic beads ini dengan sampel kita yang mau dipurifikasi antibodinya, kemudian kita letakkan di magnetic system di sini ya. Nanti setelah itu kita lakukan washing dan kita bisa mendapatkan imunoglobulin ataupun antibodi yang murni ya, dengan proses yang cepat tanpa menggunakan centrifuge dan lain-lain seperti itu ya. Kelebihannya adalah lebih cepat karena tidak ada proses sentrifugasi, kemudian lebih mudah ya. Kita hanya tinggal menambahkan magnetic beads yang telah dikonjugasi dengan protein A dan protein G ke dalam magnetic rack ini. Kemudian juga tidak menggunakan banyak antibody ya. Dan kita bisa mendapatkan sampel hasil imunoprecipitasi yang lebih banyak ya. Concentrated seperti itu. Nah, kemudian selanjutnya adalah setelah kita isolasi, kita biasanya akan melakukan kuantifikasi untuk mengetahui berapa konsentrasi protein kita sebelum dimasukkan ke gel elektroforesis ya. Nah, di sini kita support untuk dua jenis ya. Kita support untuk kuantifikasi protein yang mengandung banyak deterjen ya. Jadi kalau misalnya mengandung banyak deterjen, maka dipilih yang ini. Kalau tidak mengandung, dipilih yang bagian kiri ya. Kemudian misalnya di sini kita juga support untuk yang sudah diinkludkan dengan sampel standar ya, dan juga yang belum ada standarnya. Jadi kalau tidak ada standarnya, kita pilih yang bioread protein assay. Kemudian kalau yang ada standarnya, kita pilih quick start bread first protein assay. Dua metode ini menggunakan metode Bradford ya. Kemudian kalau yang untuk mengandung deterjen, kita menggunakan metode Lowry. Jadi ada DC protein assay ataupun deterjen compatible, kemudian ada RCDC ataupun reducing agent and deterjen compatible protein assay. Jadi kita bisa support untuk semua jenis sampel, baik yang mengandung deterjen ataupun tidak. Selain itu juga kita support untuk standarnya, baik itu yang belum didilute ya, yang masih lipolysis seperti ini, albumin ya, BSA ataupun beta globulin, kemudian juga kita support untuk yang sudah didilute. Lalu selanjutnya setelah dikuantifikasi, kita bisa lakukan dilanjutkan ke elektroforesis dan blotting. Nah, di BioRed kita memiliki paten stain free western blot, di mana proses ini bisa mempermudah Bapak Ibu sekalian untuk melakukan western blot dengan waktu yang lebih cepat ya, karena teknologi utama dari stain free western blot ini adalah tidak menggunakan proses pewarnaan, di mana proses pewarnaan ini biasanya cukup memakan waktu ya, menggunakan komasi misalnya itu memakan waktu yang lebih lama dibandingkan dengan tidak menggunakan pewarnaan ya. Selain itu, ketika kita menggunakan komasi itu, kita butuh biasanya untuk western blot butuh dua gel. Nah, sedangkan untuk menggunakan metode stain free ini kita hanya butuh satu gel ya. Tahapannya adalah kita separasi protein, kemudian karena tidak perlu proses pewarnaan, kita bisa langsung visualisasi di alat ya, bisa chemidoc ataupun geldoc. Lalu setelah divisualisasi, kita bisa langsung lakukan transfer ke membran ya. Setelah ditransfer, kita juga bisa verifikasi hasilnya apakah sampelnya sudah pindah ke membran atau belum ya. Setelah diverifikasi, kita lakukan inkubasi antibody, lalu kita bisa lakukan imaging lagi untuk melihat apakah protein target kita ada atau tidak di dalam sampel tersebut. Nah, kelebihannya teknologi stain free western blot ini adalah, yang pertama, kita bisa melakukan checkpoint pada setiap tahapannya. Jadi setiap tahapan dari mulai separasi, kemudian transfer, sampai dengan analisis western blot, itu kita bisa cek satu persatu, sehingga ketika terjadi kesalahan di tahap pertama, kita bisa langsung antisipasi. Kemudian yang kedua adalah memiliki bisa lebih cepat proses western blotting-nya karena tidak menggunakan pewarna ya. Karena menggunakan teknologi stain free, maka tidak perlu proses staining ataupun destaining yang memerlukan waktu yang lama. Kemudian yang terakhir adalah dengan menggunakan stain free western blot, kita bisa melakukan total protein normalisasi. Nah, metode ini bisa digunakan untuk menggantikan metode konvensional yang menggunakan housekeeping protein ya. Di mana dengan menggunakan stain free ini bisa lebih robust ya. Kemudian hasilnya juga lebih bagus, lebih linear dibandingkan dengan menggunakan housekeeping, karena terkadang ketika kita menggunakan housekeeping ekspresinya walaupun kita loading sama, itu bisa jadi ekspresinya berbeda-beda, sehingga mungkin datanya bisa kurang baik seperti itu. Nah, selanjutnya adalah protein gel. Jadi untuk protein gel, kita support dari mulai hand cast ya. Biasanya ini metode konvensional, kita campurkan sendiri akrilamid, bisakrilamid, buffer, dan lain-lain. Ya, kita support untuk yang hand cast. Kita juga memiliki yang fast cast gel, di mana fast cast ini proses castingnya lebih cepat, sekitar 30 menit, karena kita hanya menambahkan dua jenis reagen saja, resolver A dan resolver B, kemudian stacker A dan stacker B ditambahkan dengan APS dan TMED. Ini bisa lebih cepat dibandingkan menggunakan metode hand cast. Lalu selanjutnya adalah pre-cast. Ini jika misalnya Bapak-Ibu sekalian ingin lebih cepat lagi, misalnya karena terkadang pada saat pembuatan gel terkadang ada gagal dan segala macam ya, ketika kita menggunakan pre-cast ini akan sangat terbantu karena gel ini sudah divalidasi ya, sudah dilakukan QC sehingga pasti hasilnya akan standar ya, akan sama semua dan tidak akan terjadi kesalahan gitu ya. Tidak akan terjadi misalnya gelnya kurang terpolimerisasi dan lain-lain seperti itu. Sehingga ini sangat disarankan ketika misalnya Bapak Ibu memerlukan waktu yang cepat untuk analisis Western blot seperti itu tapi tidak mau gagal gitu ya. Kita sarankan menggunakan pre-cast gel. Nah, kemudian kita juga support protein ladder ya. Dari mulai yang tricolor, ada yang blue, all blue ya, biru saja, ataupun yang dua warna di sini, dual extra seperti ini ya. Kita support yang pre-stain, yang sudah ada pewarnaannya, sehingga pada saat loading kita bisa lihat pergerakan proteinnya, dan kita juga support yang unstained, artinya nanti dia akan muncul ketika sudah dilakukan pewarnaan. Selain itu juga kita juga support untuk ladder yang keperluannya untuk chemiluminescence ataupun fluorescent western blotting seperti ini. Untuk range-nya, jadi kita range-nya kita support dari yang 2 kilodalton sampai dengan 250 kilodalton. Rata-rata antara 10 sampai 250 kilodalton. Selanjutnya adalah protein staining. Jadi di protein staining bisa berbagai macam ya, tergantung sensitivitas yang diinginkan oleh Bapak Ibu sekalian ya. Yang paling banyak digunakan adalah Komasi, Komasi Brilliant Blue R250. Ini sensitivitasnya 36 sampai 47 nanogram. Ini waktunya sekitar 2,5 jam seperti itu. Nah, kita punya Biosef Komasi ya, di mana Biosef ini memiliki sensitivitas yang lebih bagus dibandingkan Komasi, di mana dia bisa mendeteksi sampai dengan 8 nanogram sampai dengan 28 nanogram per band-nya. Sehingga protein yang ukurannya yang jumlahnya kecil itu bisa terdeteksi menggunakan Komasi ketika misalnya menggunakan Biosef ya. Ketika kita menggunakan Komasi tidak terdeteksi, kita bisa gunakan Biosef sebagai alternatif ya. Kemudian selain itu proses staining-nya lebih cepat. 1 jam bisa selesai menggunakan Biosef ya. Lalu Biosef ini lebih aman dibandingkan Komasi di mana tidak ada barang bahan-bahan berbahaya ya di sini. Kemudian kita juga punya QC koloidal Komasi ya, di mana ini sensitivitasnya lebih baik lagi di 3,0 nanogram seperti itu. Selanjutnya adalah protein transfer system. Jadi setelah kita elektroporesis, kita transfer ya. Kita punya dari mulai wet transfer, ini adalah mini transport cell, ini metode konvensional ya, mungkin Bapak Ibu ada yang masih menggunakan. Kita menambahkan biasanya menggunakan es di sini untuk mengurangi panas ya. Kemudian kita juga support semi dry ya, transport semi dry transfer. Kemudian kita juga support yang terbaru adalah transport turbo system. Ini adalah perbedaannya. Jadi kalau mini transport maksimum hanya 2 gel dengan proses transfer sekitar 1 jam ya. Kemudian kalau semi dry ini maksimum 4 gel dengan waktu transfer antara 15 sampai 60 menit. Kemudian untuk transport turbo ini adalah produk terbaru dari kita yang dari Bioret ya, di mana untuk proses transfer ini bisa sangat cepat sekali ya, antara 3 sampai dengan 10 menit dan kapasitasnya bisa sampai 4 gel sekali running. Sehingga ini akan sangat mempermudah proses transfer ya dibandingkan dengan metode konvensional. Selain itu juga menggunakan sedikit buffer. Sehingga bisa mengedit buffer ya, dan hasilnya juga bisa lebih baik. Selanjutnya adalah blotting consumable. Jadi selain sistem transfer, kita juga support semua kebutuhan western blot dari mulai membran ya, PVDF, nitrocellulose ya, yang 0,2 ataupun 0,45, formatnya dari yang pre-cut sampai dengan raw format ya. Kemudian kita juga support blotting vapor ya. Lalu untuk transfer buffer, kita juga support premix transfer buffer. Kemudian ini adalah produk terbaru, namanya Every Blood Blocking Buffer, di mana Every Blood ini bisa memblocking proses Western Blood, ya, memblocking pada saat pertama kali kita inkubasi di membran. Ini paling cepat 5 menit. Jadi kalau konvensional misalnya menggunakan skim milk, itu hanya biasanya butuh sekitar 1 jam, menggunakan Every Blood kita hanya butuh 5 menit, ya. Kemudian kita juga support beberapa jenis deterjen, tadi sudah disampaikan seperti CHEPS, kemudian SDS, dan lain-lain. Lalu kita juga support primary secondary antibody, ya, baik itu HRP ataupun AP conjugate, ya, baik itu kebutuhan untuk Western blot, kemudian immunohistochemistry, kemudian immunofluorescence, ELISA ataupun flow cytometry. Selanjutnya kita juga support untuk antibody detection reagent, dari mulai yang colorimetric detection, ya, sampai dengan fluorescence detection, ya. Sorry, chemiluminescence detection. Ya, Clarity Western HEL ini adalah untuk chemiluminescence, kemudian ada OptiChain untuk yang colorimetric detection. Ya. Selanjutnya adalah, ini adalah BioRed Imager Family, jadi di BioRed kita punya 5 jenis imager. Ya. 5 jenis imager ini diperuntukkan dengan untuk kebutuhan yang berbeda-beda, gitu ya. Jadi kalau kita ingin melakukan imaging untuk gel dan blood, kita bisa menggunakan semuanya, dari mulai gel.go, GS900, Chemidoc SR Plus, sampai dengan Chemidoc MP. Nah, kemudian kalau kita ingin melakukan Western blot dengan analisis menggunakan chemiluminescence, kita bisa memilih yang depannya ada keminya. Jadi Chemidoc XRS Plus, Chemidoc biasa, kemudian Chemidoc MP. Nah, kalau misalnya Bapak Ibu sekalian nanti mungkin Miss Angel akan menjelaskan mengenai fluorescent Western blot, maka kita butuh imager yang bisa mengcapture fluorescence signal, di mana ini hanya bisa dilakukan menggunakan Chemidoc MP. Nah, untuk Chemidoc MP ini bisa mengcapture bisa imaging, ya, mengcapture untuk gel, kemudian chemi blood, RGB ataupun near infrared. Jadi ini adalah yang high end, versi yang paling tinggi seperti itu. Nah, mungkin karena ini produk baru, jadi saya ingin sedikit memperkenalkan mengenai produk baru GelDoc yang dimiliki oleh BioRed. Namanya adalah GelDoc Go Imaging System. Jadi GelDoc Go ini merupakan imaging yang terbaru, imaging system yang terbaru yang dimiliki BioRed, yang memiliki kemampuan untuk bisa digunakan untuk imaging nucleic acid, DNA, ya, kemudian protein. Lalu selain DNA dan protein, alat ini juga bisa digunakan untuk colorimetric detection. Jadi Bapak-Ibu sekalian, kalau menggunakan Western blot, masih menggunakan metode konvensional, menggunakan colorimetric, maka alat ini juga bisa digunakan untuk colorimetric detection. Kemudian poncu ataupun stain-free Western blot. Nah, kemudian gel doko ini juga dilengkapi dengan gel excision capability. Jadi Bapak-Ibu sekalian yang melakukan misalnya cutting gel, ya, ini sudah dilengkapi dengan gel excision capability dengan menggunakan UV shield untuk melindungi mata dari Bapak-Ibu sekalian, ya, melindungi para peneliti. Ini sudah dilengkapi dengan UV shield. Ya. Kemudian kameranya dibekali dengan 6,3 megapiksel CMOS kamera, di mana mungkin kebanyakan imager itu menggunakan CCD, ya. Jadi untuk CMOS kamera ini memiliki kemampuan cepat capture-nya. Jadi dengan proses capture yang cepat dan menghasilkan gambar yang tajam dan bagus seperti itu. Ini adalah pixelnya, jadi 3072 dikali 2048 pixel, ya. Kemudian untuk exportnya ini kita support di 16 bit data acquisition. Kemudian yang penting adalah alat ini juga sudah dilengkapi dengan touchscreen, jadi bisa digunakan stand alone tanpa menggunakan PC, jadi tidak perlu menambahkan PC untuk capture image-nya. Kemudian yang penting adalah ini, imaging areanya. Jadi imaging areanya cukup besar, ya, 21 dikali 14 cm, di mana ini bisa meng-capture langsung 4 mini gel sekaligus. Jadi 4 gel SDS page yang ukurannya mini bisa di-imaging dalam satu alat ini. Ya. Kemudian dilengkapi juga dengan image lab touch software di sini. Ini untuk mempermudah proses capture, kemudian zoom in, zoom out, ya. Kemudian sedikit editing di sini, ya. Kemudian di atasnya ini juga dilengkapi dengan spill proof washable top mat. Jadi mungkin biasanya Bapak Ibu ketika ingin meng-capture atau memfoto hasil DNA ataupun hasil gel protein, biasanya membutuhkan tempat untuk meletakkan sampelnya, ya. ini bisa ditempatkan di sini karena dia menggunakan karet ya dan tidak mudah bocor ya, sehingga bisa diletakkan di sini sebelum proses imaging. Oke, itu mungkin yang dapat saya sampaikan. Terima kasih. Nanti mungkin jika ada pertanyaan terkait produk ataupun yang lainnya bisa menghubungi kami. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for your presentation, Mas Kurdi. So that we know all about the protein related information to us. Okay. Now, I will introduce the second speaker, Angelie Koh. I would like to explain about Miss Angelie. Hello, Miss Angelie.
Hello.
Okay. Angelie has been the product manager of the protein research since July 2021. She joined Bio-Rad in February 2019 as a account manager. Before joining Bio-Rad, Angelie held a dual role position as a research assistant at Cancer Science Institute of Singapore and as a scientist at NUHS Transcend. Angelie holds a Bachelor of Science from National University of Singapore and a Master of Science from Pohang University of Science and Technology, South Korea. Okay, without wasting time, I would like to Miss Angelie to give the presentation for 45 minutes, Miss. So this time is for you, Miss Angelie.
Thank you very much. I'll share my screen. Are you able to see my slides?
Yes, I can see your slide.
Okay, so today's presentation, I think you've briefly heard a bit about from Mas Kudianto regarding the Western blotting workflow. And in particular, today I'm actually going to talk about fluorescent Western blotting. And if you haven't started it yet, why should you actually start it now? Okay, so this would be the contents for today. I'll go on to talk about the history of your Western blotting. And then thereafter, why should you actually start it now? And how do you actually do so? As well as some of the handy tips that you can use to assist you for your fluorescent Western blotting workflow. So for the history of Western blotting, this is actually how it came about, or it's otherwise known as your immunoblotting. It actually started in 1979 by Taubin's group. And what happens is that they did an electrophoretic transfer of your ribosomal proteins from the pH gels onto the nitrocellulose sheets. And then this detection of the immobilized proteins was used using radioactively labeled or your peroxidase conjugated antibodies. So after that, okay, people moved on to chemiluminescent methods because, for example, your radioactively labeled ones had actually higher toxicity. So there came the chemiluminescent methods to actually replace these kind of issues, okay? And as well as due to their high sensitivity. And initially, we actually started out detecting it on X-ray films, but X-ray films actually had a problem because they only detected about 1.8 logs of your dynamic range. So thereafter, digital imaging methods or systems have been developed because this actually gives a higher sensitivity and better resolution. And now you can actually move on to 4 logs of dynamic range. So it actually prevents your signal saturation. So for example, when you're detecting on your X-ray films, your beta actin, your GAPDH, other housekeeping proteins can actually be saturated. But you actually don't know that if you're just detecting on an X-ray film. So for digital imaging systems, you actually detect the total protein, all the proteins together, and you normalize it according to all the bands within that lane itself, instead of just the housekeeping proteins. Okay, and this is still considered somewhat semi-quantitative, which I'll explain a bit further. Okay. So what happens is that for chemiluminescent, your substrate is actually converted to the product and you actually measure the light that's produced as a byproduct. Okay, but for fluorescent Western blotting, what happens is that the level of your protein expression is actually directly related to the level of fluorescence that's emitted from this fluorophore, which is conjugated to the detection antibody. So this is actually not a very new technology. It was first introduced in 1990s, but initially the uptake has been quite slow because there's actually very high background noise. And then also the fluorescence imaging instruments were a bit limited at that point of time. Okay, so why start it now? Okay, so what happens is that you get brighter fluorophores. Your chemiluminescence, like what I mentioned earlier, okay, so what happens is that your substrate is converted to the product and then it gives off a light. So this is actually measuring the byproduct and it's somewhat meant as a semi-quantitative. Okay, for colorimetric, your substrate is converted to all these particulate products. And then for fluorescence itself, you can see that actually your fluorophore is tagged directly to your conjugate, your antibody. And once you actually excite it, it gives off a certain light. And this fluorescence would be directly related to your level of your protein expression. So as a result, you actually have a tenfold increase in your dynamic range over your chemiluminescence methods. And due to the advancements in your fluorophores and your imaging technology, you are actually able to measure a lot more. So for BioRed ChemiDoc, we actually have 6 individual LED lights. You've got your epi white, epi blue, epi green, epi red, far red, as well as the near infrared. So what this does is actually to prevent your spectral overlaps. So all these parts here, you can actually see that there are some overlaps and you might actually have a spillover of the previous channel. But because you have a very wide range from 400 all the way to 800 over nanometers, what happens is that you're actually able to space out these fluorophores and prevent the overlaps. And also for your near infrared and your far red kind of emissions, it actually minimizes your membrane autofluorescence as well. Okay, so what happens is that it's easier. You don't actually need to strip and reprobe your membranes. Initially, I think what I did was basically to actually block it, with your antibodies. And then if, let's say, you're studying phosphorylated proteins, what you need to do is actually strip that membrane and then thereafter re-block it with your secondary antibody again. But the problem with that is that what happens is that when you actually strip, you might actually strip some of your proteins which are present on the membrane as well. Okay, so all you need to do is actually to have multiple proteins which are recognized by the probes conjugated to fluorophores that have distinguishing emission spectra. And then you're actually able to distinguish proteins of related species. For example, they are phosphorylated, acetylated, as well as the proteins of very similar molecular weights. Okay, and with the ChemiDoc imaging system, you can actually detect up to 3 different proteins in one single protocol without having to go through all that process or taking the photos one by one. Okay, so for example, you can see the red bands over here, actually the phospho-ERKs, which is actually tagged by the Starbright Blue 700 antibody. And then your ERK over here, which is the green bands, is actually tagged to the dielike 800 fluorophore. And then also we have the GAPDH, which is a very special HFAP rhodamine antibody. So this antibody, I'll explain more in detail later. Okay, so you can see over here, for example, you can actually measure all the different proteins together within the same blot. Okay, so you can also have better data storage. So your chemiluminescent, usually after a while, all the signal disappears, but actually your fluorescent membranes have increased photostabilities. So what happens is that if you use the low fluorescence PVDF membranes, all you need to do is actually dip it in ethanol, air dry it, and then you make sure you cover it and make sure that there's no light exposed. And this can actually be re-imaged even up to many months later. So for us, actually, we have even tried blots that that are like 2 years later, and they can still even be imaged as well. Okay, an easier development method. So BioRed actually has a fluorescent spectral viewer, which is suitable for flow cytometry, for Western blotting and microscopy. So you can see here, you can actually input, for example, all your different kind of fluorophores that you are tagging. So in this case, this recommendation is actually to have something conjugated with your Starbright Blue 520. Over here is actually your HFAP rhodiamines. And then over here is actually your Starbright Blue 700. So these Starbright antibodies are actually proprietary to BioRed. And what it gives is that high sensitivity detection with very, very low backgrounds. And then for your HFAP rhodiamines, okay, so this is actually using our QCAL technology. And you can actually measure your actin, tubulin, and your GAPDH, the housekeeping proteins, which are tagged with a rhodiamine dye. So this is an example of the IgG. So you've got your heavy chains here and then your light chains. And instead of having all these FAB and FC portions, you actually only have one of this. So it's actually a monovalent FAB and it's conjugated with a rhodiamine fluorophore. So actually this minimizes your cross-reactivity to other species and you can actually block it with the antibodies from other species as well. And you actually do not need to add on a secondary antibody after the washing step. Okay, so how to do fluorescent Western blotting? Is it something that's entirely different from your normal Western blotting? Not exactly. You have seen these slides before, I believe. So you can actually integrate your stain-free workflow with your fluorescent multiplexing as well. Okay, so what you do is to actually run the gel to separate it, visualize it, and then after that, do your protein transfer. You can access your transfer efficiency. And after that, you do the total protein normalization and analysis thereafter. Okay, so let's start with the separation of your proteins and visualization. Okay, so similarly, you actually use the same gel tanks as you would. And this can actually run up to four different gels in a run. You can either use your pre-cast gels or you can also use the hand-cast or the fast-cast gels. So in this case, you can also use either your stain-free gels, which are very chemically similar to our normal TGX gels, or you can just use the TGX gels as well, no issues. And then you need your Lemley buffer for your protein samples. And similarly, you will need your TGS running buffer as well. So for example, if you're working with your stain-free imaging, what happens is that the All Blue standard would actually allow you to visualize your gel running. Okay, and thereafter, with your unstained standards together with your proteins of interest, you can actually do the UV activation and you can actually image all of this within the same blot as well as the gel using the Chemi.MP. So you can easily also merge the gels and blots, for example, to check how's your gel running efficiency. So for example, like this one, you do have also your fluorescent Western blottings, and then they are actually strep tech. So you can also do your chemiluminescent as well. So it's up to you which type of gels and which type of standards you would like to use. Okay, so thereafter, we actually do our protein transfer. And then access the transfer efficiency. So protein transfer wise, we have this called the transblot turbo system. If your proteins are 5 to 150 kilodaltons, you can actually transfer for as little as 3 minutes. And these are actually up to four mini gels at a time. Okay, if let's say your protein sizes are very large, okay, then the traditional wet transfer would still be recommended. And then importantly for fluorescent Western blotting, do remember to use the immune blot low fluorescence PVDF. Okay, so this actually helps to minimize the background noise. Otherwise, if you use your normal PVDF or your nitrocellulose membranes, this will actually autofluoresce, and that's not what you want in a fluorescent Western blotting. And after that, you can actually visualize how is your transfer efficiency like from the gel to the membrane. Okay, so thereafter, similarly, you would also block with your buffers. You need to make sure that you have enough wash buffer volumes. So 20 mils for your mini blots and 100 mils for your bigger, meaty blots. And you need to make sure that all these blocking buffers and antibody solutions are actually able to cover your membrane and block it properly. Okay, so you using the low fluorescence PVDF membranes, what you need to do is to actually activate it in methanol, and then after that, equilibrate in the wash buffer for 3 minutes. And you actually incubate your blot, which is the protein site up, okay, in this blocking buffer for 1 hour, and do remember to have the continuous agitation. So for example, you can actually use your every blot blocking buffer, and this actually provides complete blocking for all types of Western blots. And because it doesn't contain any phosphate-based buffers, you can actually use it to study even your phosphoproteins as well. So alternatively, you can also use your TBS with the 1% casein, and casein will actually help to lower your background noise. Okay, so similarly, thereafter, like in the normal Western blot, you actually incubate with your primary antibody and do make sure that, you know, you do have continuous agitation throughout this 1 hour. So we do have a range of this precision AB antibody range. This has been rigorously wet lab tested and validated. It's specific and it's reproducible. And you can actually order this off our catalog antibody, BioRed antibodies websites as well. Okay. And this is actually what I mentioned earlier. So we have our proprietary HFAT primary housekeeping antibodies as well. So what happens is that you don't actually need to use your secondary antibody thereafter. And it can actually eliminate any cross-reactivity with other primary or other secondary antibodies from other species as well, because this is actually fully humanized. So they are actually recombinant human housekeeping proteins. Okay. And then thereafter, you also incubate with your secondary antibody and do the washing step. So similarly, it's for 1 hour. Make sure you have continuous agitation. And then, of course, you need to make sure that you actually wash it properly so as to minimize all the background noise. Okay, so for BioRed, we do have our Starbright Blue 520 and 700 antibodies. And these actually available in different formats, like your goat anti-mouse, goat anti-rabbit formats, etc. And what happens is that you are actually able to detect very sensitively. So even if your protein levels are lower, you can actually detect it. And it's easy for you to multiplex. If let's say you actually look at the spectral viewer and make sure that there are no spectral overlaps. Okay, then thereafter, just like the normal Western blot, you actually do your total protein normalization and the analysis. Okay, so for the LF-PBDF, you can actually image it when it's still wet, or you can actually have the alternative to actually dip it in methanol for a few seconds and then air dry before your imaging. So if let's say you want to keep it long-term, all you have to do is to place it in a Ziploc bag. And then after that, you actually wrap it up in aluminum foil, or you store it in the dark so as to prevent the photo bleaching of the fluorophores. Okay, and you can analyze using our image lab software. So for example, you can see this is actually the total protein detection with your fluorescence. You can actually have all of this information within the same blot. If you would like to find out, quantify what the molecular weights are, or even have relative quantitation analysis, etc., you can do so easily using our image lab software. Okay, so some of the handy tips to actually guide you with. One is to load less, see more. Okay, so what this means is that make sure that you are actually not overloading the protein. Okay, so recommendation is about 15 micrograms. You don't actually need a lot compared to your chemiluminescent. Okay, and make sure to actually optimize each individual antibody concentration first. And then thereafter, you actually select the dilution that use the highest signal to background ratio. Because if you have too high antibody concentrations, what happens is that you can actually have non-specific binding. And this will actually result in your membrane having a very high background signal. Okay, so when you're adapting from a normal chemiluminescent protocol, you actually need to increase your primary antibody concentrations by 2 to 5-fold. So for example, if let's say you are using a 1:5,000 for your chemiluminescent protocol, you might actually want to try 1:1,000, for example, or 1:2,005 for your fluorescent Western blotting. Okay, and similarly, you also need to optimize your secondary antibody concentrations. So you can try to start off with 1:5,000, or you can check the data sheet for whatever recommendations for that particular antibody. And if let's say you are unable to detect your targets, okay, what you do is you actually dry the blot. So you dip it in methanol and air dry, and then you image again because it seems to increase the signal intensity by 4 to 10-fold. So here I actually have a little quiz for you. For example, what is the optimal primary antibody concentration to be used? So this gel was actually loaded with a protein sample that contains transferrin, which is about 80 kilodaltons. And then it was blotted onto an immune blot LF-PVDF membrane. So this membrane was actually cut into strips. Okay, each strip over here is probed with a different concentration of your primary antibody. So based on this, which one do you think would be the best concentration to actually have? Would you like to type in the chat box, or if anyone would like to unmute and speak, that's possible too. Is anyone going to try? Okay, so I have an answer. That's 1:1,000. Okay. Any other tries over here? Okay, I have 1:500 over here. Okay. So let's actually see what is the signal to noise intensity ratio. So those that guess 1:500, okay, this is actually the answer. So what happens is that, for example, when you see 1:250, you can actually see the very high background noise over here, even though your proteins of interest are actually very highly fluorescing. Okay, so this is not what we want. For 1:500, okay, the signal to noise ratio is actually 22.15. So what this means is that you get very intensely fluorescing your proteins of interest, and then this does not have a very high background unlike this one. Okay, for 1:1,000, while the background is actually quite clean, the problem is that the signal to background ratio is actually decreased to about 15. So you can see that the band is actually not very brightly fluorescing as compared to the background. And then for this, you can tell 1:2,000, this is actually quite dim already, even though we do not have a very high background, okay? So all these can actually be calculated with the image lab software as well. And then you can decide which would be the primary antibody to be used in the multiplexing assay thereafter. Okay, and to know your antibodies well, that's the second tip. So you actually should use primary antibodies from different host species, like for example, mouse and your rabbit. And what happens if, let's say, you use two very closely related species like your rat and mouse? This actually can give cross-reactivity, and they can actually detect, you know, the other protein from the other species as well. Okay, so you make sure to use the antibodies which are already highly cross-absorbed against other species to minimize that cross-reactivity. And for BioRed, we do have our HFAP rhodamine antibodies for the housekeeping proteins. So this will not react with other species as well. Okay, and also we do have our proprietary Starbright antibodies, which will help to achieve the highest sensitivity. So for example, this is actually the traditional detection methods of using the IRDAI 800 and also the Alexa 488, which we are quite familiar with. And you can see over here for your bands, these star bright blue definitely gives you a brighter band over here, and you can actually detect up to about 32 picograms. For your star bright blue 520, you can definitely see the difference in the performance. So what happens is that you do have a very high background signal over here, and you're actually only to detect around this part here. So around up to 500 picograms. But you know, with the Starbright Blue 520, you can actually detect all the way up to 32 picograms. And these conditions are actually the same, whether they are in the traditional methods or the using the antibody Starbright Blue antibodies. Okay. Make sure that you're also using clean dishes and the low fluorescence membranes to actually minimize the high background. So we do have our immune blot low fluorescence LF-PVDF membranes, which actually minimizes your autofluorescence of the membranes. And then also to use the clean dishes when you're washing away so as to have a cleaner background. So for example, you can see here, this is actually using the immune blot LF-PVDF membrane, and this is using the standard PVDF membrane. So what happens is that because the normal PVDF or nitrocellulose membrane would autofluoresce, giving a very high background signal, whereas this is actually much cleaner background. And then as per their signal to noise ratio that's being measured, so you can see that for this, you do have a very high signal to noise ratios as compared to your standard PVDF. Okay, next you can also consider having specialized blocking buffers. So there are several ways, or there are several methods of blocking buffers. You can either block it in milk for your normal Western blot, but this actually could result in your higher backgrounds if, let's say, they are not washed properly, because milk tends to have a more unspecific binding. And these particulates from the milk can actually settle on the membranes, and this can actually create your fluorescent artifacts. Okay, so for BioRed, we do have for every blot blocking buffer. Remember, you can actually use even for your phosphoproteins. So this would be suitable for your fluorescent Western blotting as well. Otherwise, you can actually consider having your casein buffers, or you can add maximum of up to 5% of your non-fat dry milk, or you can use your BSA in TBST. So all these are more specialized for fluorescence detection. And do make sure that you actually filter, sterilize all your blocking buffers before you use them. Okay, so as to minimize any particulates that can actually cause your fluorescent artifacts. Okay, so for the sample buffer wise, it does contain your bromophenol blue, which will actually fluoresce. So what happens is that you need to make sure either you let the gel run further so that the dye front would actually migrate away from the sample, or otherwise you can actually just cut off the portion of the gel containing the dye front. Okay, and also to avoid your cross-channel fluorescence. Or you can add... Sorry? Okay. No worries. If you have any questions, you can also type in the Q&A, and then I think we can answer that later as well. Okay, so to minimize your cross-channel fluorescence, so what you would need to do is to have fluorophore conjugates with very different your emission and your excitation spectra. And like I said, you do have to optimize the detection of each target individually, okay, before you actually move on to a multiplex experiment. Okay, so your strongest target should always be in the blue channel, okay? And then after that, the middle one in the green channels, and your weakest target, those that's of lowest abundance, put it in the red channel. Okay, so this is an example that actually contains your GST, which is the green one here, and also your soy trypsin inhibitor, which is the red one. And this was run on the gel, blotted, and immunodetected with a rabbit antibody against GST and mouse antibody against the soy trypsin inhibitor. So you can see that for the red channel, actually this is okay. So your mouse antibody is actually just detecting your soy trypsin inhibitor and this has no issues. But then what happens is that if you use a non-cross absorbed GST antibody, it can also detect over here, weakly detect your mouse primary antibody as well. So you actually get a spillover. And you know what you are detecting here may not necessarily just be the soy trypsin inhibitor. Okay, make sure that you are using the correct standards. So for example, your normal Western blot, some people would like to use the kaleidoscope protein standard because this actually gives you know the very nice color indication when you're running the gel. However, for fluorescent Western blotting, this actually results in your blown out, very overexposed kind of standards. And if you are using, for example, the stain-free gels, you can actually mix your unstained gels your unstained gels to visualize it during your gel activation as well as the transfer. And then you can also use your all blue, for example, or you can also use your fluorescent fluorescent protein standards as well. Okay. And also, if let's say you intend to keep it, you should actually protect it from light. So if you are just doing a normal fluorescent Western blotting for the usual steps, you don't actually have to really do it in the darkness. It's more for the long-term storage of it. Okay, so you can keep it like what I mentioned in the Ziploc bag, and then you actually tightly cover in an opaque container, cover it with aluminium foil, and then you can keep it in your fridge. And this will actually help to minimize the autofluorescence. Okay. And if let's say some of you would make some stocks of your fluorescently labeled antibodies, this should actually be stored in the dark to prevent any photo bleaching. Okay. And always remember to handle your membranes with care. Okay. So if possible, you know, use the blunt forceps to actually handle the membrane, because sometimes if you have scratches or creases, that can actually result in your fluorescence artifacts. And if you use a pen marks, these pen marks can actually show during your fluorescence imaging. So the recommendation would be to either use a pencil if let's say you need to annotate anything, or you can actually use the annotation function on the ImageLab software as well. And these annotations, if let's say you want to export out your images, it can be also exported out together with your membranes. So not to worry, you know, sometimes you might forget, you know, what lane is this or how the special annotations for your particular proteins. Okay, and also try to use powder-free nitrile gloves because sometimes the powder can actually get onto the membranes and this can actually result in artifacts and, you know, all these fingerprints, etc. They will actually fluoresce when you are doing the fluorescence Western blotting. Okay, so can you actually multiplex with the stain-free gels? So if let's say you are currently using the stain-free workflow, yes, you can. Okay, so what are these stain-free gels? They are basically formulated with a trihalo compound, and this actually binds to your tryptophan residues in your proteins. So after that, when your gel is activated by your UV light, what happens is that all your proteins that contains all these tryptophan molecules and the trihalo compound, they will actually fluoresce. Okay, so when they're excited, they will actually fluoresce. And so you can actually do your total protein normalization. Okay, but what happens is that because your stain-free fluorescence adduct is excitable by the short wavelength, which is like your UV and your blue wavelengths. So this will actually be visible if you're using your lower wavelength. So your shorter wavelengths, your blue fluorophores. So if let's say you are using your stain-free gels for your fluorescent Western blotting, do remember you actually keep the blue channel for your total protein detection, okay, using your stain-free. And then after that, the red and the green channels, leave it for your proteins of interest. So like what I mentioned earlier, the red ones, you should use it for your weaker targets, those of lower abundance, and the green ones for moderate abundance. Okay, so thank you very much. And yeah, please let me know if, let's say, you have any questions.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Angelie. Thank you for your presentation. Very interesting. So we can detect up to 3 different proteins, yeah, in a single protocol.
Yes,
it correct. It will be saving the time and more easier without stripping and reprobing of the membrane and also fewer reagents used. Okay, because there are already several questions that have been entered in the Q&A chat, I will read the questions to the speakers. Okay, for the first questions, come from Pak Sony to Mas Kurdianto first. The question is, what is the differences between Chemidoc and Geldoc, and why Geldoc cannot be used for chemiluminescence? Can Chemidoc can be used to visualize data in agarose gels? If not, why? Kepada Mas Kurdi.
Okay, terima kasih Pak Sony atas pertanyaannya. Perbedaannya adalah di Chemidoc ya, itu ada chemiluminescence detection. Jadi kalau di Geldoc itu tidak dilengkapi dengan untuk menangkap sinyal chemiluminescence, sehingga di Geldoc kita tidak bisa mengimage ya atau memfoto hasil chemiluminescence dot karena tidak memiliki channel ya, tidak memiliki detection untuk chemiluminescence signal, sehingga walaupun signal chemiluminescence-nya ada, itu tidak bisa kita foto hasilnya seperti itu. Nah, jadi perbedaannya adalah ada di chemiluminescence detection signalnya. Ya, jadi ada device untuk mengcapture chemiluminescence-nya, sehingga berbeda antara Geldoc dengan Chemidoc ya. Kemudian untuk Chemidoc, apakah bisa digunakan untuk DNA? Yes, you can use Chemidoc to image DNA gels, protein gels, and also chemiluminescence blood. So you can use for all purpose, yeah, for DNA, protein, and also blood. Jadi kalau misalnya chemiluminescence atau Chemidoc itu bisa digunakan untuk semua aplikasi dari mulai DNA, protein sampai dengan chemiluminescence blood seperti itu. Itu mungkin dari saya.
Baik, terima kasih Mas Kurdi. Okay, I hope the answer can answer your question ya Pak Sony. Okay, for the second questions come from Pak Sony again. The questions for both of speakers to Miss Angelie and Mas Kurdianto. The question is, can we use ELISA antibody for Western blot antibody from native page? Okay, maybe Miss Angelie can answer the question first. Hello, Miss Angelie?
Yeah, okay, can.
Okay.
Actually, right, you can actually use, sometimes it depends on your product insert sheet, some antibodies can actually be used in your Western blot as well as in ELISA applications. So of course, for Western blotting, what happens is that you are detecting it, you are doing the gel electrophoresis, so it's one extra step. And then ELISA is actually just the capturing of all those detection antibodies, which is, So what happens is for certain antibodies, if let's say it's indicated in the product sheet that it's suitable for both a Western blot or even fluorescent Western blot and also your ELISA, you can actually use it. But if let's say they say that it's very specific only for Western blotting and not for ELISA, then you can't actually use it. So it really depends on your product insert sheet. Just look at what your insert sheet of the primary antibody say.
Okay, I think maybe other additional answer from Mas Kurdianto.
Seperti yang Mbak Angel sampaikan ya, jadi antibody itu biasanya mereka didesain untuk beberapa aplikasi. Jadi kalau misalnya kita cari antibody, itu adalah nanti dia akan dijelaskan di situ ada beberapa antibody ini bisa untuk apa saja. Jadi ada yang khusus untuk ELISA, ada yang khusus untuk Western blot, atau misalnya ada beberapa jenis antibody yang bisa digunakan untuk semua aplikasi dari mulai ELISA, kemudian Western blot, kemudian IHC seperti itu. Jadi tergantung karena ada beberapa antibody yang tidak, yang khusus misalnya untuk ELISA dan tidak bisa digunakan untuk Western blot. Tapi ada juga yang antibody itu bisa digunakan untuk semua aplikasi. Jadi tergantung. Biasanya sudah ada hasil validasinya kalau kita mencari antibody seperti itu.
Thank you, Mas Kurdianto, for your answer. Maybe the next question to Miss Angeline. Okay, the question is, in your presentation, you mentioned the advantage of fluorescence multiplexing. Membrane can be stored and analyzed within months. So will it affect the result or reduce the fluorescence intensity later maybe?
Okay, so if let's say you protect it very carefully from light, so actually we do have in our wet lab that we use for some of our wet lab demos. What happens is if let's say you store it very carefully in your Ziploc bag so as to remove any contaminants, and thereafter we actually keep it in a container and wrap it up very tightly with your aluminium foil. So if actually all these are done very carefully, you'll realize that yes, over like, for example, many, many months later, the fluorescence intensity would decrease by a little, but essentially you would just need a slightly longer time to detect. You do not actually need to, you know, restrip or reblot again. Yeah, so if you protect very carefully, yes, you can actually detect without any issues, even without any decrease in intensity over just a couple of months is fine.
Oh, okay. So the maximum can be stored at a month.
Our Western blot has been actually our fluorescent Western blot has been there for 2 years. We don't
know 2 years
maximum.
Okay.
So we will find out maybe next year if let's say we notice that the fluorescence intensity goes down, then we will make a new blot then.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Maybe the next questions. I just curious about that. So far, what I know is that secondary antibodies have higher concentrations than primary antibodies when we use in Western blotting. So why is the multiplexing method is the opposite? From that I know, maybe you can explain about that.
Yeah. Okay. So for multiplexing, what happens is that if you actually have very high specificity from the start, okay, so your primary antibody concentrations would need to be higher so that they specifically bind to the particular proteins of interest that you want. And thereafter, because the detection of the secondary antibodies is actually more efficient, like what I mentioned, it's actually more efficient in a fluorescent Western blot. So you don't actually need such a high concentration of your secondary because they're very, very sensitive already. What you need is that very high specificity right at the start.
Okay. Maybe Mas Kurdianto, any response or any additional answer for that question, Mas?
Okay. Maybe I have a question, Angelie. So can we say that fluorescence Western blotting is more sensitive than chemiluminescence?
Yes, you can. So actually it is up to even up to about 10 times more sensitive than your chemiluminescence, which is already very sensitive if let's say you are using a stain-free as compared to a housekeeping protein. So for fluorescence, the Western blotting, you actually get even higher sensitivity from that. Only caution that you need to make sure is that if let's say you are multiplexing, for example, you need to make sure that, you know, there are no spectral overlaps and your whatever that you are measuring, you know, doesn't spill over into the next emission or excitation of the other fluorophore. So that's the only thing that you would need to be careful about. But otherwise, yes, it is more sensitive than chemiluminescence.
Okay. Angelico, I have a questions. I just curious how to optimize protein and antibody concentrations on this method to give the optimal results. Maybe it's possible to explain again the optimization scenario. Maybe.
No problem. So for you need to optimize by parts, and you need to do it you can actually run all your protein. So you make sure that you standardize your protein amount that's being loaded so that, you know, you don't have varying protein amounts. Okay, so you what happens, like just now, for example, you all together in the same gel, and then what happens, you can cut it into strips. And for those particular strips, individual strips, you can actually blot it with different concentrations, from a lower, you know, to a higher concentration. And thereafter, you can actually see which is the best concentration to be used. So the best concentration would be the one that gives you that higher signal to your background noise. So that is for your primary antibody. And then similarly, for your secondary antibody as well, you actually can, after blocking, after optimizing what, for example, just now that plot, 1:500 is the optimal for your primary antibody, right? And then thereafter, you can actually block it with, try out to block with different concentrations of your secondary antibody. So for example, 1:5000, you can do 1:10,000, and then 1:2500, et cetera. And then actually check which is actually the optimal signal to noise ratio. So that as a result would give you the best signal.
Thank you. Maybe the last questions. I think, are multiple primary or secondary antibody incubated at the same time? Or we must incubate separately for each antibody, each target?
So for example, your HFAP antibodies, right? What happens is that it can actually be incubated in the start. And then after washing step, you don't actually need to re-incubate or anything with the secondary antibody. So that HFAP would still be located together even with your secondary antibody proteins. Mm-hmm. Okay, but then as best practice, I think usually we try to separate for both, because what happens is that you want the proteins, your primary antibodies to bind to your proteins very specifically first for your primary antibodies. And then thereafter, you actually have the secondary antibodies, which have the fluorophores to actually bind to whatever that's bound very specifically. So we try to separate for this.
Okay. I see the questions from Sekar FKUI. The question to both of you, Miss Angeli and Mas Kurdianto. Is there any special trick for protein less than 20 kilodalton? We have tried using fluorescence Western blot and it still doesn't show up. We use 50 microgram of total protein from cell culture. Maybe Ms. Angeli can answer the question first.
So I think there are many parts, I guess. Okay, so if let's say it's less than 20 kilodaltons, okay, make sure you know it doesn't run too close to your bromophenol, for example. If it's too close to your diaphragm and you had cut it away, for example, it would not show up because you might have cut the protein away. Okay, the other thing is I see that, you know, actually a lot of the total protein, 50 micrograms, in fact, it was already loaded. For fluorescence Western blotting, remember I said actually to load less proteins. So interestingly, you might actually need to decrease your number, your amount of protein, because what happens is that if there are too many proteins which are actually closely placed together, due to this quenching, fluorescence quenching, they might actually not detect your protein if you are loading too much as well. So that's the interesting thing about fluorescence. You might not actually use so much proteins. And then another thing is, of course, make sure you are actually using your correct secondary antibodies. So like what I showed earlier, so your Starbright Blue, you know, for example, it has a lot higher sensitivity than, let's say, your Alexa Fluor 488. So if you are trying to detect very small amounts, you know, during using your Alexa Fluor, you might not actually detect it. But if, let's say, you were to change your antibodies to the Starbright Blue 520, you could actually detect it. Yeah.
Okay, maybe other additional answer from Mas Kurdianto.
Ya, mungkin trik ya. Apakah ada trik khusus untuk protein di bawah 20 kilodalton, kemudian sudah mencoba dengan fluorescence, doesn't show up? Nah, sebenarnya ketika ada kasus tidak bisa terlihat di blood ya, apakah misalnya pertama kita harus cek dulu apakah di gelnya itu sudah terlihat atau belum ya? ketika misalnya sudah terlihat di gel, kemudian pada saat kita transfer ke membran, karena 20 kilodalton itu lebih kecil dari 20 kilodalton itu proteinnya cukup kecil. Ini agak tricky ketika kita mentransfer ke membran, ya. Jadi kadang-kadang misalnya ketika kita transfer ke membran itu tidak semua protein tertransfer, bahkan ada beberapa kasus proteinnya itu tidak tertransfer ke membran. Jadi ketika kita deteksi dengan antibody itu tidak akan terlihat di membrannya. Jadi memang ketika misalnya tidak muncul di blood ataupun di membran, itu kita harus cross-check dulu ke belakang. Apakah proses transfernya sudah berjalan dengan baik? Ya. Apakah memang misalnya di gel? Ya, apakah memang misalnya di gelnya sudah ada itu protein 20 kilodalton? Kemudian setelah ditransfer, itu apakah sudah ada belum di membrannya? Ya. Jadi makanya mungkin beberapa trik yang bisa dilakukan, yang pertama adalah kita bisa lakukan QC step dulu. Sebelum diinkubasi antibody, mungkin dicek dulu apakah di membran sudah betul-betul ada atau belum itu protein 20 kilodalton. Kalau memang sudah ada, bisa dilanjutkan dengan antibody. Nah, ketika misalnya protein itu tetap masih tidak terdeteksi, beberapa kasus kendalanya adalah di antibody-nya. Jadi beberapa kasus adalah di antibody-nya, kita harus benar-benar memilih antibody yang sesuai atau sesuai antibody yang sesuai. Seperti yang tadi disampaikan Mbak Angel, ya. Jadi kita harus mengukur kira-kira berapa sih konsentrasi perbandingan antibody, ya. Apakah 1 banding 2000 atau 1 banding 500 untuk menentukan konsentrasi antibody yang paling tepat untuk bisa protein itu terdeteksi seperti itu. Mungkin sebenarnya case seperti itu ada banyak yang harus bisa dicek, ya. Mbak Sintera, ada banyak yang harus kita kita troubleshooting, itu memang butuh banyak sekali step, ya, harus kita cek satu persatu sampai kita bisa menemukan case-nya, karena ada banyak faktor yang bisa mempengaruhi protein itu tidak bisa terlihat di pada saat kita analisis, walaupun menggunakan fluorescent Western blot yang bisa dikatakan ini lebih sensitif, tapi ketika misalnya ternyata proses transfernya tidak berhasil, maka tidak akan terdeteksi seperti itu.
Thank you, Mas Gurdianto. We have additional questions to Miss Angeli and Mas Gurdianto, maybe. Okay, the questions come from Hastuti. Okay. To detect cytokines in serum when the ELISA process is optimal, can fluorescence Western blotting can help the optimal results? Please advise to determine the cytokines or chemokines in serum. Thank you. Maybe Ms. Angeli and Ms. Cordianto.
Okay, so for example, if let's say you are measuring certain cytokines or chemokines, like for example, your CCL, I think CCL11 or like CD, there are a few antibodies like CD121, CD122, 123, etc. We do actually have the fluorescence conjugated antibodies available on our BioRed antibodies website. So yes, you could actually try out fluorescence Western blotting detection methods for this, because this could actually increase the sensitivity and you may be able to detect these chemokines or your cytokines better. So yes, but not for every particular chemokine or cytokine. So it really depends, because some of them are more suitable for ELISA or Western blotting protocols only. Some of them are actually available in your fluorescence tag formats. Yeah.
Okay, Mas Gurdianto, maybe any additional answer, Mas?
Ya, mungkin di sini yang ditanyakan adalah apakah bisa juga Western blot digunakan untuk mendeteksi cytokine, ya, dalam serum, ya. Jadi sebenarnya ketika kita mendeteksi protein, memang tujuannya ada beberapa macam, ya. Jadi kalau misalnya menggunakan ELISA, itu artinya kita biasanya ingin mendeteksi konsentrasi. Jadi to detect the concentration of cytokine in the serum, gitu, ya. Tapi kita tidak akan mengetahui kira-kira sitokin ini berapa bobot molekulnya. Nah, kelebihan Western blot ini adalah selain dia mendeteksi keberadaan sitokin dalam serum, dia juga bisa mendeteksi berapa molecular weight-nya. Jadi tergantung tujuannya. Jadi kalau misalnya ingin juga mengetahui molecular weight-nya, fluorescence Western blot juga bisa sebenarnya digunakan. Tapi tergantung tadi tujuan penelitiannya apa. Kalau memang tujuannya hanya ingin mengetahui konsentrasi beberapa jenis sitokin misalnya dalam serum, kurang kalimatnya. Oh, ketika ELISA tidak optimal. Oke. Ya, jadi ini yang ditanyakan adalah ketika when you use ELISA is not optimal for detection of cytokine, Angeli. So, yeah, when we use ELISA, then the detection is not optimal. Can we use fluorescent Western blot to help detect the cytokine? This is there's additional
additional answer.
I realize there's a typo. Okay, so if let's say your ELISA is not optimal, but ELISA and Western blotting are slightly different protocols. I would say that even if you were to transfer, because ELISA actually lacks of the final Western blotting, that final step over there. So I would still say you would need to optimize, you know, even before you actually move on to fluorescent Western blotting. Yeah.
Ya, mungkin dari saya ada tambahan ya. Jadi ELISA atau ELISA juga banyak sebenarnya tipenya. Jadi ada fluorescence ELISA, ada chemiluminescence ELISA. Jadi kalau misalnya kita menggunakan ELISA biasa, menggunakan misalnya ELISA yang berbasis kolorimetrik, ya, itu sensitivitasnya akan lebih rendah dibandingkan ketika kita menggunakan chemiluminescence ELISA ataupun CLIA. Ya. Chemiluminescence ELISA ini akan memiliki sensitivitas yang lebih tinggi. Ataupun bahkan ada FLIA ataupun fluorescence fluorescence. Jadi deteksinya menggunakan fluorescence. Itu juga akan lebih sensitif lagi. Sehingga mungkin ketika misalnya metode ELISA yang digunakan adalah ELISA konvensional, atau menggunakan colorimetric detection, maka mungkin bisa dicoba untuk menggunakan ELISA dengan deteksi yang berbeda seperti misalnya chemiluminescence ELISA, karena sekarang sudah beberapa banyak berkembang ya ELISA itu sudah contohnya misalnya chemiluminescence ELISA itu sudah banyak digunakan sebagai alternatif ketika menggunakan metode konvensional ataupun ELISA biasa itu tidak bisa mendeteksi sitokin, karena beberapa sitokin ini konsentrasinya sangat kecil di dalam serum gitu, maka dia beralih ke chemiluminescence ELISA. Jadi ELISA-nya deteksinya chemiluminescence. Sama dengan Western blot ya. Western blot itu kan ada colorimetric, kemudian sensitivitasnya dinaikkan. Kalau kita ingin mendeteksi bisa menggunakan chemiluminescence. Jadi mungkin itu. Jadi bisa mencari produk alternatif seperti chemiluminescence ELISA atau untuk sitokin ya. Kita punya ada Bioplex ya di BioRed. Ya, yeah, I think BioRed have Bioplex, Angeli.
Yeah, correct.
So, yeah, you can try the Bioplex detection for multiplex analysis because I think Bioplex has more sensitive than conventional ELISA.
Correct. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Terima kasih Mas Purdi. Thank you. I think there are no more questions for the participants. So we have arrived at the end of the webinar session. Okay, thank you Angelico for sharing your knowledge and technology with us.
Thank you very much.
And thank you.
Thank you
for your time to participate in the webinar.
No problem.
Okay.
Thank you.
Maybe we will take a photo together.
Okay, sure.
Mas Willy, mau sekarang?
Okay.
Counting, Mas. Counting.
Your own camera. I'll do a screenshot. 1, 2, 3, go. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Miss Angelico.
Thank you. Bye.
Baik, Bapak Ibu, rekan-rekan semua, semoga webinar ini dapat menjadi solusi dan inovasi dalam penelitian kita. Ya, saya mau mengucapkan terima kasih atas partisipasi Bapak Ibu karena telah meluangkan waktu untuk mengikuti webinar ini. Sebagai informasi tambahan, sertifikat dan materi akan kami kirimkan ke email peserta yang telah mengisi link absensi yang tertera pada kolom chat. Saya selaku MC dan moderator memohon maaf apabila terdapat hal yang kurang berkenan di hati rekan-rekan sekalian. Baik, wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Kita akhiri webinar pagi ini. This is the end of the webinar session. Angelico, thank you for your participation.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Kita masih nunggu ya. Nunggu ini aja sampai.
Aku masih standby, nggak apa-apa kalau Mbak Centera atau Mas Kurdi mau close.
Oh, Mas Billy masih standby?
Iya, Mas standby, santai aja. Sampai habis.
Oke, okay. Ini udah mau habis kok, udah mau. Saya juga standby aja, nggak apa-apa.
Oke, siap.
Terima kasih, Bapak-Ibu.
Terima kasih banyak, Bapak-Ibu semuanya.